Pope Francis met US Secretary of State Antony Blinken in the Vatican on Monday. It's not entirely clear what the pair discussed.
So the New York Post editorial board accusing the federal government of using social media giants to censor Americans who oppose the president's policies.
This is a world pandemic. It's a 1-in-100-year event. So you can expect that we will have transmission from time to time, and that's just the way it is. We've got to accept that this is the new world order.
Why don't you tell us the World Health figures that 99.4% of cases around the world today are mild?
A crisis being used to further encroach on human rights without any analysis, and the easy acceptance by a lot of TDs that this is happening.
Authorities in China take harsh measures, working to control the country's emerging virus outbreaks. Residents reportedly sealed inside their homes. That's if they don't comply with harsh pandemic restrictions. The gate of a neighborhood is welded shut soon after a confirmed virus case was discovered there. Residents living in some city high-rises heard cries for help.
There will be no return to the old normal for the foreseeable future. I repeat, there will be no return to the old normal for the foreseeable future.
A number of years ago, a young preacher labeled myself a conspiracy theorist because of my biblical position on prophecy. What exactly is a conspiracy theorist? Who first coined or popularized the phrase? Now, I'd like to give a disclaimer. This study is only for people who are truly seeking God and want to know what's going on in the world. And as I encourage at all times, please research everything you see in this study.
My fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country.
Here is a flash from the Associated Press, Dateline Dallas. Two priests who were with President Kennedy say he is dead of bullet wounds.
Good evening as we come on the air in the West tonight, and we begin with that breaking headline, those top secret JFK files. The president tweeting they were coming today, the final batch of classified documents from the assassination of President Kennedy.
Who killed John F. Kennedy? The commission answers unequivocally, Lee Harvey Oswald. Was Oswald acting alone, or was he a member of a conspiracy? The commission answers, he acted alone.
But even from the day the president was shot, most Americans had their doubts.
Documents are withheld by the FBI, the CIA.
Intelligence agencies did all the wrong things if they were looking for conspiracy.
On Friday, November the 22nd, 1963, at 12:30 p.m., an event took place in the United States of America that was to send shockwaves around the whole world. The youngest elected and the 35th president and the commander-in-chief of the United States of America, John Fitzgerald Kennedy, was assassinated in Dallas, Texas at the age of 46. His vice president, who succeeded him, Lyndon B. Johnson, put together a committee to investigate the assassination. When it was completed, it was called the Warren Commission. But there was a very big problem with this report. It was compiled way too quickly, without a very thorough investigation, and half of the American people were not buying it. They did not believe that a lone gunman acted alone. They believed that other players were involved, who the powers that shouldn't be were protecting. So the Central Intelligence Agency, better known as the CIA, sent out a telegram, for they caught wind that many people were accusing them of being behind the assassination of JFK. And anyone who thought outside of the mainstream report or the mainstream narrative, as you can vaguely see at the bottom of this now declassified dispatch, they labeled as conspiracy theorists. The New York Times were able to get a copy of these overseas cabled messages dated to April 1st, 1967, which are now declassified, and it documented 10 years later in an article dated to December 26, 1977, that a CIA document, recently declassified under the Freedom of Information Act, provides a detailed account of at least one instance in which the agency mustered its propaganda machinery to support an issue of far more concern to Americans and to the CIA itself than to the citizens of other countries. Conspiracy theories, the cable went on, have frequently thrown suspicion on our organization. For example, by falsely alleging that Lee Harvey Oswald worked for us. The aim of this dispatch is to provide material for countering and discrediting the claims of the conspiracy theorists so as to inhibit circulation of such claims in other countries. Whoever assassinated John F. Kennedy will probably only find out in the day of judgment. But it is clear that the CIA were either the first or one of the first major institutions or organizations that labeled anyone a conspiracy theorist who questioned the official narrative. And this trend has expanded into mainstream thought worldwide. Anyone who even questions the official accepted narrative is accused of being a conspiracy theorist, continuing the false accusations of the Central Intelligence Agency, the CIA. Scientific American asks, why do some people believe in conspiracy theories? And why do people cling to them during uncertain times, according to the Business Insider? Well, maybe because after a while, evidence comes out that confirms that some of it is actually true. And when the US government convinces most of the global media to sell a lie to the public to justify invading another nation's country for its natural resources, and that is based on a complete lie, you cannot really blame people for losing confidence in their governments for being dishonest. And some have seen the benefits of conspiracy theorists.
Some of it is ludicrous and some is quite reasonable. Governments do keep things from us.
And perhaps for that very reason, Professor Yuzinski thinks a little dose of conspiracy thinking actually may be good for democracy.
Conspiracy theorists have for decades pushed for the release of more documents relating to the JFK assassination. Mm-hmm. That's a good thing. Conspiracy theorists pushed for the 9/11 commission. That was a good thing. A world without conspiracy theories might be a very dangerous one, because at that point, no one's able to question power structures.
In the United States, half of Americans believe in conspiracy theories, according to the London Guardian. 60% of people in Britain believe in conspiracy theories, according to the South China Morning Post. And 8 in 10 French people believe in them, according to France 24 News. The reason the narrator is sharing these volumes of articles from the corporate-controlled mainstream media is because he is showing you what they can do and what they will do in the not-too-distant future when they want to single out and target a community of people, isolating them from the rest of society by speaking with one unified corporate voice. Chatham House wants to counter the challenge of conspiracy theorists. The United Nations UNESCO says think before sharing conspiracy theories. The New Yorker talks about the danger of conspiracy theories and gives a list of them. The Washington Post says three reasons conspiracy theories are more dangerous than ever. Vanity Fair says the creeping danger of conspiracy theorists. The Economist says conspiracy theories are dangerous. Here's how to crush them. The New Statesman says why conspiracy theories are deeply dangerous. And Princeton University says that conspiracy theories are more dangerous than ever. So who do they believe are more inclined to believe in conspiracy theories? Scientists claim that people who believe in creation are more inclined to lean towards conspiracy theories, according to the British newspaper, The Independent. And another British newspaper, The Daily Mail, also says that people who believe in a God who created Earth are more likely to believe in conspiracy theories. Very interesting. When you believe in creation, It sets you apart from the rest of mankind because you give honor and complete homage to God, who has put everything you see in place in order by a divine act. In a previous study titled The Creation Story, we looked at the beauty of creation and how God intricately designed every single creature with absolute pinpoint precision and detail that the naked eye can see, and even things that can only be seen through a lens or a microscope. Each creature has its own unique identity with its different shapes, colors, and distinct smells. And when the earth is created anew, animals that were once herbivores that are now carnivores will go back to being herbivores over again. As shown in previous studies, animals that we were once led to believe were carnivorous through the lies and deception of modern scientific literature and films, the evidence that has been unearthed and has recently been discovered confirms the creation story, and not the unscientific, secular, pagan account that reptiles were at one time in the very beginning herbivores. It is amazing how many people all over the world actually believe that everything that they see around them just appeared from nowhere and came about all on its own, and they believe that creatures are able to fly, swim, crawl, run, eat, and function in its own environment by natural selection. That is really weird, it just does not make sense. But the narrator never knew that creation was such a contentious issue, and that the origins of the earth created so much deep, intense conflicts. There are those who believe that the world was created by a big bang. They have still yet to explain where the bang has come from, but the narrator has come across an issue that many have attempted but failed to draw him into over the years concerning creation. There are a number of people who have been sucked into this belief that the earth is flat, and they are trying to make it salvational. Now, the narrator wants to make it very clear that he does not care if the world is shaped like a three-dimensional cube, or if it is triangular in shape like a pyramid, or if it is spherical in shape. God wants us to focus on him as the creator. That is the emphasis of creation. If you have a 1611 authorized version of the Bible, in the margin of Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1, it says that the earth was created in 404 BC. This is why many Christians say the earth is roughly 6,000 years old. The man responsible for this was Archbishop James Usher, the Irish-born 17th century primate of All Ireland, whose 1654 The Annals of the World first makes that claim. Another Irish-born British mathematician, William Thomson, chair of natural philosophy at the University of Glasgow and president of the Royal Society, better known as Lord Kelvin, in one of his earliest papers, he claimed that the earth was over 100 million years old. And there are people in both camps who have also tried and failed to get the narrator caught up in the age of the earth. As nobody was there as an eyewitness to when the foundation of the earth was created, it is better that you accept by faith that the earth is created and just leave it there. Anything else should be for each individual's own private study. There is a reason why creation is vitally important, for it keeps society stable and in order, and the narrator will explain why. At creation on the sixth day, man, meaning both male, masculine, and female, feminine, was created. Man is very distinct for his growth of facial hair from a beard, mustache, or his sideburns. His distinct deep voice that changes once he grows into an adolescent, and his biological organs that produces sperm that keeps the cycle of life going. He has a Y chromosome and an X chromosome. Males are much more physically stronger, as they have proportionately more muscle mass and bone mass. Women have two X chromosomes but no Y chromosome. Their voices are higher pitched and they have a higher percentage of body fat than men. Their body goes through a hormonal menstrual cycle that produces an ovulation and a period. They have nipples like men, but they grow into breasts once they turn into an adolescent. And they have protein that produces milk that helps to feed a newborn child. Though there are similarities, there are also clear differences. It was God who instituted the very first marriage institution at creation between a man and a woman. And this is where their distinct functions come into play. Most who want to continue the cycle of life know that their unique biological organs have to work together to keep each generation going. And history has shown that in every community around the world from antiquity, it is the family unit that keeps a society stable with an even equilibrium balance. But not everybody believes in creation and God's ideal. And there is a movement that, though small in number, have turned into a powerful political lobby and is pushing for God's institution to be replaced. They have been recently labeled the Alphabet People, and they have been able to cleverly silence people who oppose their plans. That shows that something very sinister is at play. And even if people in their own community even dare to question their agenda, the aggressive nature of the cancel culture knows how to cleverly keep them in line. There are a number of famous celebrities who are unaware that they're being used as puppets for the invisible government, who claim that they want to be identified as gender fluid. They do not want to be identified as the pronouns of neither male nor female, and they are very cleverly indoctrinating young children into this anti-creation agenda, where the most influential musicians are also promoting cross-dressing. Now, where can cross-dressing be traced to? According to a man who was once a part of the Alphabet movement, he documented that among shamans, divinatory power is linked to bisexuality. In the ritual gesture of the Anasurma, the magician dressed as a woman lifts up his robes to express his sex, thus appearing as an androgyn. An androgyn is an individual who can either pass as both a male and a female. Is this individual a female or a male? And is this individual a male or a female? Disturbing. The Etruscan prophet, he says, carried a phallus attached to her belt. In the mysteries of Hercules Victor in Italy, the god, as well as the initiates, were clothed as women. Cross-dressing in the secret societies was supposed to promote health, youth, and vigor, and to lengthen life expectancy. And Hollywood is very subtly promoting this gender change.
I think we got sucked into Jumanji and we become the avatars we chose.
So that means
Bethany?
Oh, wait, Bethany, don't look at it! No!
I'm an overweight middle-aged man.
In a book titled After the Ball, published in 1989, it cleverly documents how they will slowly condition the people through the media to be more accommodating to the Alphabet community by constantly using imagery that will eventually desensitize the public's minds. And even though most will not admit that the majority of abuses they experience comes from within their own community, sadly, the modern churches, who very few people take seriously because of their recent unbiblical position, have become very empathetic to this movement. And the Alphabet community have observed that if they can get the influential people in the churches on board, then their agenda is more or less complete, because that is where they have always had the strongest opposition. And the liberal community of contemporary Christian music, which has the greatest influence on the young, is how to capture the current generation in the churches. It is turning into a very, very intense tug of war that is intensifying, and it is deeply dividing different cultures, and people are realizing that their agenda is encroaching on other people's human rights, and countries all over the world are approaching it differently. In Norway, you can face up to 3 years in jail if you criticize the Alphabet community publicly, according to Reuters News. In the UK, a man who wanted to be identified as a woman complained when a woman criticized him. So the case went to the highest court in the UK, and the judges, Justice Mark David John Warby on the left and the Right Honourable Sir David Bean on the right, said that in the UK, people should be given the right to criticize and offend without facing a police investigation, for they are exercising their right to free speech, a very rare case in the UK. In the United States, there is a very intense ongoing tug of war concerning it. In Russia, Vladimir Putin says teaching gender fluidity to children should be a crime against humanity, and that the agenda should not be enforced and imposed on children. In Chechnya, they have a very, very low tolerance level for them, and they round them up and either torture them, and many times they kill them. And in Ghana, the government have made it a criminal offense to partake in such behaviors, with 85% of the population supporting the bill. So as you carefully observe this movement, it is primarily designed to undermine creation. So we have seen that in some portions of the world, we have two different forms of extreme. One state can incarcerate people for speaking against the Alphabet community, and another state can even kill and torture people who are partaking in the behavioral practices of the Alphabet community. Now, whether you agree with these practices, that's down for individuals to debate among themselves. But the reason I'd done the previous study, the creation story, was to lay a foundation for this study, because I saw that creation is going to be severely attacked. And we've understood that a conspiracy theorist is someone who questions the official narrative. Now, they could be right, they could be wrong in their conclusions, but if you question the official narrative, you'll be labeled as a conspiracy theorist. So who else besides a creationist do they identify as a conspiracy theorist? On the Isle of Patmos, a Greek island in the Aegean Sea, the Book of Revelation, originally titled in Greek, The Apocalypse, was primarily written, do you want to know why? To teach not just a small community of people only, but the entire world to remember the past history of this earth's beginning in the creation story, and to also prepare the entire world for the future recreation of a new heaven and a new earth. This is recorded in Revelation chapters 14 and verses 6 and 7, where Jesus gives a clear divine instruction to his church that they should be stepping outside of their comfort zone and should be teaching the entire world in love and not by arguing or debating about the memorial of creation. And in Revelation chapter 21 and verse 1, we are also instructed to tell not just the church community only, but the entire human family in the world, who are all of different languages, different shades of brown, are of different cultures, and who have different beliefs about how this current earth will be recreated and it will be replaced after the second coming of Christ, where there will be no more sin ever again. So it is very interesting that creationists are being falsely labeled as being more inclined to be conspiracy theorists, according to modern day scientists. So who else do they consider as conspiracy theorists? According to the British newspaper The Daily Express, conspiracy theorists warn of a new world order spearheaded by Antichrist. Now, there is only one teaching in the world that forewarns of a new world order, and it is also found in Revelation in chapter 13 and verse 15 and chapter 14 and verse 9. Very interesting. Now, people are going to respond very differently. There are those who will be deeply moved that the God of heaven sacrificed and died as an innocent substitute for fallen man, to prepare them a place for eternity. But there will be those who will not be interested at all and will be greatly influenced by the dominant, mesmerizing media narrative.
Do you know how many the world is ending meetings we've had over the last 2 years?
Drought, famine.
Hole in the ozone is so boring.
Yep, they'll be saying boring, heard it all before, and there'll be others who will just laugh in your face. But don't think that people are not paying attention to what is taking place in the world according to those prophecies. Deep down, many know that something is not right in our current world, and even if they don't have the correct interpretation, they are at least trying to search out in that prophetic book the global conditions on the earth. So you have a right to tell people. Imagine if you have friends and family and they found out that you know what is taking place. And they will say, wait a second, so you knew all these things are going to happen and you didn't even bother to tell me. Yep, many will not be impressed. They can see that liberties that they once cherished are slowly being stripped away from them, many times behind the scenes. But they just don't know the cause, and that is where you, as Christians, step in. People are also observing that documents are coming out from the mainstream press and from the most respected medical journals that has proven that we are not always being told the absolute truth. And those who study recent history are very well aware what a state can do to its citizens when they either pose a threat or do not come in line with the status quo. And we have to learn from events in ancient and modern history. What is very sad is that it is the world that is saying that we are living in the end times, according to the London Independent newspaper. But the church theologians are teaching, well, we are not living in the end times. That's just those stupid prophetic alarmists who are using fear tactics, and they are in line with the teachings of the papacy that is also teaching that we are not living on the edge of prophetic history. That's the extremist wing of the church, they say. The world, the papacy said, is going to end with peace, not annihilation, says the current pope. Well, that's what he thinks. When the Lord comes back to this earth, it won't be no quiet secret rapture. It is going to be the most frightening event this world will ever see for those who are eternally lost. Your finite minds can't even begin to imagine how the huge mountains and the different islands in the sea are going to be shaking to and fro. For Revelation chapter 6 verses 14, 15, 16 and 17 tells us that every mountain and every island are going to be moved out of their places. And God is asking every one of us, believer or unbeliever, a very serious question concerning his second coming. For the great day of his wrath has come, and who shall be able to stand? And the two earthly systems who have been prophetically described as the first beast and the false prophet that will be imposing the global new world order upon the whole of mankind will also be destroyed by God. And don't let anyone trick you into believing that the current Western powers will be replaced.
For the last 500 years, the Western world has basically determined the terms of engagement around the globe, and suddenly that is coming to an end, and they're at a complete loss. And,
sure.
And what?
Sure.
How could this possibly happen?
Well, right now, there are 200,000 U.S. troops stationed at more than 800 bases in 70 countries and territories outside the United States.
These 800 bases around the world represent a massive system of military power that isn't often talked about.
According to the forewarning of the Book of Revelation, it will be the Western powers who will be wrapping things up on the prophetic map. And there is one power, the longest running man-made institution on the earth, who is definitely not too comfortable with people identifying her as the first beast in the Book of Revelation. And she, being one of the forerunners of the cancel culture, can cleverly silence those who she opposes and ridicules those in influential political positions and labels them as conspiracy theorists so that people will be distracted. The Southern Poverty Law Center, the American nonprofit legal advocacy organization, also published an article titled Catholics and Conspiracies, where she also ridicules people who have historically identified her. The papacy has a very powerful support base in both the religious and political world, and the Pope not only warns his own bishops to not get involved in conspiracy theories, but he also warned against so-called false preachers on social media. He was very careful not to mention them by name. Even at the Doors has spent 10 years identifying the two kingdoms in the book of Revelation chapter 13. The older one, the papacy, and the second and the younger one, the United States of America, who has been identified as the second beast with two horns and the false prophet. And though they have never really differed from each other in colonizing other people's territory, the younger will be using all of her military and economic might to enforce the entire world to give homage to the elder one. One of the ways this will be successful is via the global outreach of her education through entertainment, where she cleverly markets her military endeavors, justifying what she does by glamorizing her destructive economic expansionist interests around the globe. We become desensitized to the extreme violence committed by her military by praising the actors who are pawns for the military-industrial complex. These video games and films are a sort of psyops programming, a preparation ground for the future, for people to accept America as the world's global police. But how has the younger been able to last so long? Her autocratic power expanded under Alexander VI, the Spanish Pope who was born into the infamous noble family, the Borgias, who is the godfather of modern global Western imperial colonial expansionism. And his endeavors were documented by a man who taught rulers to gain power by force, flattery, fraud, and deception. In his book, published around 1513, titled The Prince, the Italian Renaissance diplomat Niccolo Machiavelli said that people are so gullible and are so caught up with immediate concerns that a con man will always find someone ready to be conned. Pope Alexander VI never did anything but con people. That was all he ever thought about. And he always found people he could con. No one ever gave more convincing promises than Alexander or some greater oath to back them up, and no one ever kept his promises less. Yet his deceptions always worked, because this con man knew this side of human nature well. When Barack Hussein Obama was elected as the 44th president of the United States of America, the London Guardian in 2009 documented that he was awarded two top prizes for his masterful combination of new media, door-to-door and community grassroots campaign with a clever tactical use of traditional TV advertising. When the late British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher won the Falklands War in 1982, it got her re-elected back into power in 1983. When she was first elected in 1979, she invoked the prayer of the Catholic saint Francis of Assisi. What Machiavellian tactics did they both use to retain prestige? He continues. Nothing wins a ruler respect like great military victories and a display of remarkable personal qualities. Alexander VI, who more than any other pope in history, showed what could be done with finance and arms. His achievements enhanced the power of the church. A ruler must act in a way that everything he does gives an impression of greatness, spirit, seriousness, and strength. The ruler who projects this impression of himself will be highly thought of. There is nothing more important than appearing to be religious. In general, people judge more by appearance than first-hand experience, because everyone gets to see you, but hardly anyone deals with you directly. Everyone sees what you seem to be. Few have experience of who you really are. So true. This is how the papacy has maintained her power and global prestige on the world stage. And the Holy Scriptures in Revelation chapter 13 verses 3 and 8 tells us that the majority of the inhabitants of the earth will eventually have a deep sympathy for her. Our finite minds will struggle to comprehend it, but we have to, by faith, believe that this will come to pass. How will that be possible? Revelation chapter 13 and verse 4 says that the majority of the world will worship the papal beast and the dragon who gave it its power. But who is the dragon? In both Revelation chapter 12 and verse 9 and chapter 20 and verse 2, the Bible, being its own interpreter, is clear that the dragon is one of the titles that symbolically represents the chief of the fallen angels, Satan. So how exactly do people follow or worship Satan? In Matthew chapter 16 and verse 23, Jesus calls his disciple Simon Peter Satan when he clearly misunderstood Christ's role in redemption. And Jesus made it very clear that when you put your own teachings to replace God's word, you are following Satan. This is why 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 10 says that the majority of the world will eventually perish. Do you know why? Because they rejected the love of the truth, which are the deep promises in God's word. And the inhabitants of the earth will only continue to follow the same deceptive path of that self-worship philosophy that was first introduced by the serpent to man at Eden. From a secular perspective, in a book published in 1896 titled The Crowd, A Study of the Popular Mind, the French polymath Gustavo Le Bon said, "The masses have never thirsted after truth. They turn aside from evidence that is not to their taste, preferring to deify error if error seduced them. Whoever can supply them with illusions is easily their master. Whoever attempts to destroy their illusions is always their victim." So true, the masses are always followers. In a book titled The War on Gold, the late British-American economist Anthony Cyril Sutton also said that those entrapped by the herd instinct are drowned in the deluges of history, but there are always a few who observe, reason, and take precautions and thus escape the flood. Most people in life follow the herd instinct so that it can fit in and not be left out, even if they know it's wrong. And from very young, the narrator would closely observe that most people generally follow the popular crowd. But in the final showdown on earth, there will be the odd individuals who will stand out. And even at this time, each individual on earth is deciding their future destiny. And history has always shown us that God always gives man free will to choose his own individual path. But we will soon get to a stage in earth's history where there'll be two clear and distinct camps on the earth, and everyone is going to have to make a choice of their future destinies. There'll be those who have the name or the heavenly character of God the Father in their foreheads in Revelation chapter 14 and verse 1. And there'll be those who have the name or the earthly character of the beast in Revelation chapter 14 and verse 11. We shall distinguish the two groups. In Revelation chapter 14 and verse 12, it singles out the only people on this earth who will not cave in to the final global decree. The Bible identifies them as saints who have patience, who keep the commandments of God, and have total unbending faith in God's word. So how do they get that level of patience? In James chapter 1 and verse 3, and in Romans chapter 5 and verse 3, they acquire that patience through tribulations, which is great inward sufferings, and through a deep faith in God. The Bible calls them saints. Now, what exactly is a saint? According to Psalms chapter 50 and verse 5 and 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verses 1 and 2, a biblical qualification of a saint are those who are a member of the Church of God, that call upon the name and are sanctified in Christ Jesus by the word of God, who have made a covenant or a holy agreement with God by sacrifice. The Holy Scriptures also said that they keep the commandments of God. Now, there are many Christians that teach falsely that Jesus nailed the commandments to the cross. They sadly have a misunderstanding of the ceremonial law in Colossians chapter 2, verses 14 to 17. Now, in 1 John chapter 5, verses 2 and 3, after the crucifixion, the apostles and the inspiration of the Holy Spirit is unequivocally clear that God's Ten Commandments are deeply rooted in love, and it ends with, are not grievous. In Matthew chapter 22, verses 36, 37, 38 and 39, before the crucifixion, Jesus laying the foundation also described the Ten Commandments as the moral law, also said that it is rooted in, guess what? Love. In the Epistle to the Romans in chapter 13, verses 9 and 10, the Apostle Paul saying the exact same thing as Christ, that the Ten Commandments is rooted in, guess what? Love. They also have the faith of Jesus, which according to Romans chapter 3 and verse 22, is the righteousness of God. So these will be the only people on the earth who will be separated from the rest, who will be faithful to God to the very end. Now, the United States' very own SEAL has openly told you what her future plans are. She does not even hide it. And what the Commander-in-Chief wants to implement from door to door is leading into something a lot bigger. For there are men in the academic community who are singing from the exact same song sheet, preparing to isolate those who do not conform. And what America has been doing for years to people it has colonized and enslaved, the dominant tribe is now feeling its effects on themselves. And she is the only system that qualifies on the prophetic map as the false prophet, for she has the economic power to use her military might to impose a global decree. According to Revelation chapter 13 and verse 17, Revelation chapter 14 and verse 11, and Revelation chapter 15 and verse 2, the majority of the inhabitants of the world will embrace at least one of these five things highlighted in green. They will either follow the beast, or follow the image, have the mark, have the number, or have the name. And one of these five things are all connected with, guess what? Worship. According to Revelation chapter 13, verses 15, 16, and 17, a global economic weapon will be used to enforce a very brutal spiritual tyranny that will include a global death decree where no man cannot buy or sell. How will that upset the whole equilibrium of the world? In central London, on a road off Regent Street, there is a statue of the 18th century Scottish economist and philosopher Adam Smith. And he wrote a huge volume work published in 1776 titled The Wealth of Nations. And on the opening page, he wrote that the annual labor of every nation is the fund which supplies it with all the necessaries and conveniences of life, which it annually consumes, and which consists always either in the immediate produce of that labor or in what is purchased with that produce from other nations.
The U.S. economy runs on consumers. Consumer spending accounts for nearly 70% of economic activity in the United States. And many Wall Street economists feel it's the U.S. consumer who's keeping another recession at bay.
If each one of us as individuals have to be truthfully honest with ourselves, even if you're not materialistic, we all like purchasing new things. Keep it real now, don't be fake. You all know that when you either try on a brand new slick item with your true friends who are not haters, women know exactly what we are talking about. Or when a new item arrives at your house and you almost fall down the stairs when you hear the Amazon delivery at the door, you cannot wait to open the package. It is trade that keeps all nations financially stable. And e-commerce is what drives many of the big tech companies like China's Alibaba, that depends upon the system of both buying and selling, just like Amazon. Now, when the lockdown first started in the West, restaurants suffered greatly. Some even went bust. They couldn't keep up with the rates. And we know that if there is one thing we all need to even stay alive, it is food. And as most of us do not grow our own food, we have to be completely dependent upon the agribusiness industry. The narrator lives in the UK, and in the year 2020, according to study Statista, people in the UK spent 103 billion British pounds consuming food, and the leading stores like Tesco, Sainsbury's, Asda, Morrison's and Aldi earned in revenue 192 billion British pounds in the year 2019. Now, the narrator would like to ask everyone watching and listening a very serious question. What if that privilege of food consumption is taken away from you? How do you cope? Or how do you even survive? Does it sound a little bit too far-fetched and extreme to you, or a conspiracy theory? As most states around the world are coming in line with the global requirements, threatening innocent people's individual livelihoods that helps to feed their families, in some states around the world, it is already happening as a pilot scheme. And what will happen on a micro level is going to expand on a global macro level. And the very sad, dire economic conditions of many of the states in the world is making that prophecy seem ever more real than ever before.
The United Nations is calling on Lebanon's government to do something to address the country's worsening economic meltdown. 2 years into the country's financial crisis, the UN estimates 78% of Lebanese citizens live below the poverty line. 36% live in extreme poverty.
There's not enough food, medicine, or fuel. The economy is broken. Even with a job, it's hard for most Cubans to buy the basics. And then throw in a pandemic. The people, they're tired.
Around 3 out of every 4 Venezuelans now live in extreme poverty. But this isn't just happening here. Hunger is spreading like a virus across Latin America and the Caribbean. A new report by the UN found more than 59 million people in the region are going hungry. That's an increase of more than 13 million people in just 1 year. The hardest hit countries being Haiti, Nicaragua, Honduras, Bolivia, Ecuador, and Guatemala.
1 in 12 Americans are now jobless, and many children are growing up with little hope of long-term employment.
Around the world, consumers are grappling with the soaring cost of food. Prices now at their highest level in a decade, according to an index tracked by the UN.
In Brazil, for example, President Bolsonaro attempts to revive his political standing by handing out coronavirus aid to the poorest, inadvertently pushing up the price of rice by 76%.
On our projection, children in Africa will account for around 55% of all extreme poverty in the world by 2030.
I very rarely like putting my emotions into a study. I try to stay as neutral as possible. But since I was young to this very day, if there's one thing I struggle at looking at, it is poverty and suffering. And this next section, I found real difficulties to edit. It was looking at Afghanistan. And when I was looking at the suffering that is taking place out there, it is really affecting me. I had to stop editing for a while. It was really a battle. But we're going to see a model of how they can use you can't buy or sell on a state.
Latest studies estimate there are now 2.9 million drug users in Afghanistan, the highest per capita in the world.
Afghanistan is a country that grows the largest poppy field on earth that supplies 80% of the world's opium. According to geologists, it has the best-renowned emeralds in the world in terms of quality. It has gold mines. It has oil. It also has a gas pipeline that links and connects Central Asia. And it also has $1 trillion worth of untapped mineral wealth. Why it has been invaded by a foreign occupation, very few people know. But since the eerie opening of the 21st century, every year, or you could say nearly every month, all you see is article after article where there are constant reports of innocent people being killed either by NATO drones or by the US and her coalition soldiers. It is very, very sad. What did they do to deserve this? Neither age nor gender is spared, and very few of these soldiers are held accountable for these horrible, senseless crimes against humanity. And those who do attempt to speak out against their own country's crimes, well, they have different ways and means of using the cancel culture, depending on how high profile you are. While many think that this all happened as a response to 9/11, then you are mistakenly wrong. Those who thoroughly do their research or just look at what the mainstream news is openly telling us, you'll see that Afghanistan has not had a quiet break from Western imperial intrusion for over 40 years. That's a whole generation. If you listen to some of the gospel music back in 1981, when they were talking about Bible prophecy and describing the climax of Earth's history, even they were mentioning the embryonic beginnings of that war on the first album of the group, The Winans.
Question is, when will Jesus return? I want you to know.
Soon.
Look at the crisis in Iran. Russia's already invaded Afghanistan. It's falling in sand.
During the Cold War, into the 1970s up into the early 1980s, you can see that Afghanistan was kind of blended with both Western and Eastern culture in the way that the civilians are dressed. Most of the women dressed quite westernized, but it sadly became a geopolitical playground during the Cold War between Russia and the United States, as you can see by the clips of these recent films. And when global players have geostrategic interests, they are not too bothered who comes in the firing line. Most wars have always been over land expansion. This may look like a recent phenomenon, but all the way back to the days of Alexander the Great, the Western powers have attempted to colonize Afghanistan, and it was revived at the zenith of British imperialist colonialism during the 19th century, during the reign of Queen Victoria. This was the time that the advent of photography was taking shape, and in its early stages, the British captured their negotiators, their military on horseback, and their Afghan allies and foes. You see, Afghanistan was boarding the prize of the British Empire, India. And like their distant Anglo-Saxon cousins in the 1980s, the United States of America, who only continues the British Empire's wars, it did not want Russia to get a foothold into that territory. But the British were not always successful. And what we have seen in the 21st century is only a continuation of the 19th century. In a book titled The Devil's Game, the very underrated writer Robert Dreyfus, giving a background to the conflict, said that the British, for whom Afghanistan was the playground for the great game of the 19th century, and who had long-standing colonial ties to Pakistan, which at that time was India, had an extensive history of dealing with tribes and religious leaders of the Pakistan-Afghanistan area. The London Guardian, also documenting the historical background to the conflict, said that in the late summer of 1842, two British armies marched through Afghanistan to avenge the destruction of a force sent 3 years earlier to effect a regime change in the Central Asian Kingdom. As it marched, the Army of Retribution leveled villages, burned crops, cut down precious trees, slaughtered all livestock, and frequently raped and killed. As you can see, nothing really does change, for Hollywood has flooded our senses with films looking at the world from a Western colonial imperialist perspective that has portrayed Afghans as terrorists and the United States and her allies as either heroic war heroes or victims. A very clever neo-colonial tactic. But what is the reality of the longest war in US history? There are Australian SAS soldiers who are deeply traumatized of the damage they have committed to innocent civilians in that country. And it is even far worse in the United States of America. Suicide has been deadlier than combat for military, according to the New York Times, where since 9/11, military suicides are 4 times higher than deaths in operations, according to NPR News. Over 7,000 are killed in war operations, but there are 30,177 suicides by men who are traumatized by the dark imagery of war that most of us will never see. In a book titled War is a Racket, a late US military general foretold us that war is a racket. It always has been. A few profit and the many pay. Out of war, nations acquire additional territory. If they are victorious, they just take it. This new acquired territory promptly is exploited by the few, the selfsame few who wrung dollars out of blood in war. The general public shoulders the bill. And what is the bill? This bill renders a horrible accounting. Newly placed gravestones, mangled bodies, shattered minds, broken hearts and homes, economic instability, depression and all its attendant miseries, back-breaking taxation for generations and generations. And these are the sad effects.
Children sift through Kabul's garbage piles for scraps of food. It's a daily routine for these displaced families in the Afghan capital.
This is what hunger looks like. Malnourished infants, a common curse in Afghanistan, but now worse. Poverty is predicted to grip 97% of Afghans by next year. Clinics and hospitals are collapsing. Supported by foreign funds, their budgets were frozen or cut when the Taliban came to power.
International community should help us like before. If they want to punish the government, this is the not right way. Now this punishment is for our people, for our children, for our women.
Successive US presidents always continue where the other has left off. They do not create a new US foreign policy. Obama's "a change is gonna come" and Trump's "make America great again" was the exact same thing, and during the time that they are in office, and even when they leave office, each one of them accumulates a mass of wealth. But what happens to the living conditions of the civilians of the countries that they invade? The late US geopolitician Zbigniew Brzezinski, in his 1997 book, The Grand Chessboard, documented that it is the United States that controls both the World Bank and the IMF. And these economic giants that bankrupt states only intensify world poverty. And since 2011, the US government was already cutting aid to Afghanistan. And what it has done is just crippled the economy and ruined the country, making it one of the poorest in the world. We are seeing an example of what America can do to a state on a micro level, which will eventually do to the entire world on a macro level, with the "no man might buy or sell" prophecy. She does it to other states also. her aid cuts are increasing poverty in Central America. And in Latin America, Venezuela is one of the countries where the sanctions have been lifted, but its devastating effects have already damaged the country. They have the highest internally displaced people on the earth. The US aid cuts to Yemen have also sadly intensified the poverty and increased the famine. And Iran has not only had medicine shortages because of aid cuts, but the United States have seized over 30 websites that are either owned or linked to Iran. We can see where this is leading to, but it's Iran and Afghanistan's neighbor where the pilot scheme for a global surveillance state is being tested.
Reporting in Xinjiang, in China's far northwest, feels like traveling in a war zone.
The security here is incredibly tight. There are armored cars on the street, police stations on every corner, and tons of surveillance cameras.
In the past year, police have stepped up security. The region is now under what's probably the most intense government surveillance in the world. Here, China is experimenting with futuristic spying technologies. To be in Xinjiang means being checked every day, multiple times a day. When you go to a market, when you drive a car, when you take a train, even your smartphone is checked.
Though most of us live in states that are not as extreme as portions of the People's Republic of China, through our technological devices, we are still being integrated onto a grid in a digital global village. While many feel that it is an intrusion of their space and privacy, and sadly there are very cold-hearted and lonely hackers who are intruding to people's private space through their smart devices, we were forewarned about this over 20 years ago in the year 1998 when two films told us what they are going to do. They are The Truman Show and Enemy of the State. So not like you were not told. One thing the narrator can say about the United States of America is that they will always give you a heads up first, even if you can't clearly see it. Edward Snowden is only confirming what they already said. The men who run the big tech were also younger at the time these films were released. And while many think that these guys are these original tech wizards, these Harvard-educated PayPal mafia men inherited all of their technology from the Department of Defense, better known as the Pentagon. And we shall explain in a while how. Every year at the Sun Valley Conference, the heads of the US media and tech come together to see how they can expand their brands and have a greater influence over the public. It is like a sort of mellowed down Bilderberg conference, and its attendees are men and women from both big tech and the intelligence community, such as Bill Gates and William J. Burns, who is the current head of the CIA. The following articles from all these mainstream Western publications will document how big tech is just a continuation of the US military technology, so that you can see for yourself that the companies that have literally swallowed up the entire planet are nothing more than children of the Pentagon. The British military historian who writes under the pseudonym Nigel West is considered as the most respected intelligence and espionage writer in the world. The big tech's technology comes from the Secret Services, and he published a book in 1986 titled GCHQ, where he showed us where the roots of this technology comes from. SIGINT, he said, is the much misunderstood abbreviation used by the intelligence community for the terms signals intelligence. This, the most aspect of covert information gathering and the most difficult research, also includes interception, direction finding, and traffic analysis. Since 2000, the Sun newspaper said, we've been introduced to iPods, Skype, DAB, podcasts, Blu-ray, Wi-Fi, digital downloads, e-commerce, HD, which is high definition, iPhone, and Wii, and in particular, tweets. 2004, Facebook is founded by four Harvard students. 2005, YouTube is online. Facebook and Twitter make their money by tracking, storing, and selling information about their users. That's the fasting pact you sign when you register. London, England has been the test bench for a range of tracking products, says London's Evening Standard newspaper. In the 1960s, the USA Today says, the DoD developed the original global positioning system, GPS. The idea was to use satellites to determine a user's position on Earth by measuring his or her distance from three peripheral satellites in a process known as trilateration. It was developed in the 1970s by the Department of Defense researchers and was built over the following two decades. The technology, initially designed as a guiding tracking system for fighter planes, boats and missiles, today is used in many civilian applications from personal to commercial aircraft navigation systems. The biggest tech companies' valuations rise into trillions of dollars, and their products now touch the lives of citizens on a daily, even hourly basis, says the Financial Times. America's tech sector has long been intertwined with the military, ever since the US government became a huge spender on early semiconductors and other expensive equipment that lacked a commercial market. Historian Margaret O'Hara, a professor at the University of Washington, has written that whether their employees realize it or not, today's tech giants all contain some defense industry DNA. The Pentagon has been a part of the Silicon Valley story all along, says the New York Times. Defense contracts during and after World War II turned Silicon Valley from a somnolent landscape of fruit orchards into a hub of electronics production and innovations ranging from mainframes to microprocessors to the internet. The American tech company rests on the foundation of the military industrial complex. So the technology we have in our hands today is nothing more than products that were around before many of us were even born, that has been handed down to us via the US military. But today, these semiconductors that are key to the tech world is the key that integrates the entire planet for surveillance.
Everything's being digitized. And so semiconductors are in almost every product we use, from home appliances to cars, and now even more so with electric vehicles. They're in the cloud, they're in our smartphones, they're in just so many things in our lives.
Whether we realize it or not, we rely on the cloud for everything, from working remotely with colleagues to ordering delivery from our favorite restaurants. The cloud is a globally interconnected network of millions of computers in data centers around the world that work together to store and manage data, run applications, and deliver content and services. The Microsoft Cloud keeps your data protected across more global data center regions than any other cloud provider, from the United Kingdom to the United Arab Emirates, South Africa to South Korea.
The pandemic has accelerated digital transformation in a way that we have never seen before.
Carl, AT&T is signing up to be a bigger Microsoft customer. The company just now announcing a new multi-year collaboration. Source tells me the deal is worth more than $2 billion.
AT&T's WarnerMedia and Discovery's are creating a standalone company by combining operations to form a new global leader in entertainment.
In a move that would reshape the entertainment industry, large parts of what belonged to 21st Century Fox would become the property of Disney. 20th Century Fox Film and Television, Sky BSB, the National Geographic channels, the FX networks, Star India, and its Hulu streaming service.
Moving on, it's one of the largest media mergers since the pandemic started. Liberty Global and Telefonica agreeing to combine their UK operations.
With all of these major billion-dollar mergers by huge US conglomerates, competition by small startup companies will be almost impossible. And unbeknownst to your average person, they are slowly integrating every section of the entire planet into one global village, making it almost impossible for anyone to live off the grid. And these companies are invading every single aspect of your everyday lives, and they are taking us right back to an ancient imperialism that existed in the so-called Republic of Ancient Rome. In the British Museum in the Roman section, there is a small statue of a man, and he holds in his hand, according to Virtue's English Dictionary, fasces, which is a bundle of rods with an axe bound in along with them, anciently borne before the superior magistrates as a badge of their power over life and limb. That is fascism. It is explained in a book titled Wall Street and FDR, where the late Anthony Cyril Sutton tells us that from 49 BC to 44 BC, Julius Caesar had his New Deal public works project. In 91 AD, Domitian had his equivalent of the American Construction Council to stop overproduction. The ultimate fall of Rome reflected all the elements we recognize today. Extravagant government spending, rapid inflation, and a crashing taxation, all coupled with totalitarian states' regulation. Big business attempted to oppress the little man. The similarities between World War II and today is strikingly identical. The war built up and produced a number of billionaire families in Europe with great human loss. And the recent global lockdown has made billionaires trillions. It has also seen human loss. In Nature magazine in 1940, at the start of the Second World War, an article titled Aspects of the Totalitarian State said that the cooperative order is essentially an effort to, and listen to these words very, very carefully, to interlock the entire occupational and social structure with the centrally controlled political hierarchy, and it cannot respect the difference between persuasion and brutal force. That is fascism, a corporate takeover. Forbes in 2019 saw the rise of totalitarian technology via the expanse of these conglomerates. And the Daily Telegraph in October 2020 said how we are heading right back to totalitarianism. AT&T, even before the merger, was already spying on US civilians for the deep state. And we can get a picture of where it is all leading to. But with her corporate takeover of Discovery and WarnerMedia, they have bigger plans. Though the official mergers will not be officially completed until mid-2022, Warner Media has an immense impact over what people watch, not just in the United States only, but all over the entire world. And she owns all of these different companies that shares either the news or entertainment. But what is Warner Media's overall game plan? For every system has an ethos. Her own website confirmed that her aim is to shape modern culture via entertainment. This trend started with the US entrepreneur whose animated characters were a reflection of his alter ego, the late Walt Disney, who worked with the CIA to buy land to export his ideas to the American public and the wider world. And the agency also works with actors to shape people's views about their wars. And while people have this very daft impression that films like Avatar are anti-colonial, it was the US military who were working behind the scenes that cleverly shows the US Marine as the hero of the film. And many are clearly observing that the US government is using entertainment to market her foreign policy and subtly plant seeds in the minds. So the Pentagon is not just behind big tech, but collaborates with Hollywood also. But where is this all leading to? In Revelation chapter 13, verses 13 and 14, the younger power is going to use some kind of supernatural act to coerce the entire planet into a global worship. How will that be possible? In a book titled Occult Theocracy, published in 1933, the late New York socialite said that in this age of wireless and airplanes, One of the fads of the modern highbrow is to scoff at such things as sorcerers, magic, and evocations as old wives' tales, tales of ancient history. There are people who refuse to believe in the existence of the supernatural, perhaps we should say supernormal, even when confronted with the evidence. Such are the skeptics who deny everything. Necromancy is partly divining magic and partly operative magic. The practice consists in the evocation of the spirits of the dead. Fallen angels will often manifest to people without being called, for occultism flourishes now in Europe, Asia, and America. Almost 100 years after this was written, witchcraft is becoming more and more accepted in mainstream society, and the occult does not have no racial barrier. And studies are now proving that both atheists and agnostics are now more open to the supernatural or the occult. The groundwork is now being laid, and the Red Table Talk generation are training minds to be more accommodating to modern paganism, where some of the most influential female entertainers are opening the door to the worship of the serpent, and Hollywood is educating the world into humanism and the occult.
It's hard to tell what's right or wrong.
Who cares about the rules? We can do what we want.
The power inside you. All over the world, there are different names for it. But it's one thing. One power. And women who can touch it. We protect the world.
This is what the end of the world looks like. At least we have front row seats.
All of this edutainment, its humanist philosophy, and its very mesmerizing special effects in both the music and film industry is cleverly training and conditioning the mind for a final showdown and also reviving a lost art. The first people to use surround sound to mesmerize their audiences with special effects through an instrument called the magic lantern was by a 17th century German Jesuit priest, Athanasius Kircher. You see, all roads are eventually leading to Rome, and the ideologies that once scoffed at by a priestly class of men, the sons of Loyola, is now unconsciously being embraced by the modern world. In a book published in 1930 titled The Power and Secret of the Jesuits, the late Austrian historian René Fuller-Müller said that Jesuitism is for the most part the expression of Loyola's personality. We meet obvious traces of Jesuit influences in our present-day culture. What are they? Many traces of Jesuit influence also remain in the theatre and above all in the schools. According to the New York Times, in Nazi Germany, the Bible was replaced with stories of war heroes, Nordic myths, and German folklore. And in our modern Western schools, like the edutainment industry, they are also following suit, where God is replaced by humanism. And just as the word of God was attacked in Nazi Germany, the same attack takes place in our modern culture. This is confirmed by René Fuller-Müller, who praised the Jesuits when he said that it should not be overlooked that the advantages as well as the disadvantages of our humanist classical education are for the most part attributable to that pedagogic activity which at one time was spread by the Society of Jesus over all the countries of the world. He continues, for certain effects or special effects, the fathers even made use of the magic lantern. The Jesuit savant Athanasius Kircher having been one of the first to draw attention to this possibility. Athanasius Kircher also laid the foundation for inquiry into hypnotic phenomenon, what today we call mesmerism. In our days, when the whole conception of good and evil has undergone considerable changes, as the film trailer of Multiverse showed, the worldly wisdom and the laxity of which the Jesuits were accused in earlier centuries meet with far more understanding. And the modern reader of the earlier anti-Jesuit polemic literature will feel more than once that many of the Jesuit principles stigmatized as the product of corruption are much nearer to our modern ideas than are the stern medieval opinions of the Jesuits' enemies. So modern day secular thinking leans closer to papal Rome, and this Jesuit priest, Pope Francis I, the most famous Jesuit in history, has not only met with the leaders of the largest tech corporations on the earth, with the details of their meetings being kept secret. Though they have always monitored their clients, the systems they control are leaning ever more closer to one of the instruments of the Spanish Inquisition, spying, that is, monitoring society so closely that they have a complete knowledge of what everyone is doing. And also the heads of these tech companies are training their users to closely monitor their very own family and friends for the state, which a number of people are sadly already doing, not looking at the bigger picture. Though people love to hear about the intricate goings-on of the papacy and the United States and its role in international affairs, if any church wants to truly prepare a dying world for eternity, they have to make sure that they are living up to what they preach. Recent studies have shown that there are over 45,000 different brands of Christianity worldwide, all claiming to be God's true church. Now, God does have a true church on earth, and it is those believers who live up to what he says in the Word of God. And if they really want to be taken seriously, they're going to have to learn how to confront and heal their own internal divisions and rifts. Look at these newspaper articles very carefully from the secular press. They have observed that the church is the most racially divided institution on the whole earth, as shown in previous studies. Now, the narrator has been questioned and has been challenged over the years by unbelievers who have said to him, "Why is your church so divided over race?" And the question the narrator would like to ask a number of the viewers: how can you prepare a world for something that they cannot see being practiced and lived out in your own church community and in your own lives? They will not take you seriously. Now, there are other things that the world has closely observed.
The governing body live at a complex they call Bethel, or the House of God, in New York State. This world headquarters is a 100-acre site that replaced a sprawling Brooklyn campus, sold off in recent years for over $1 billion. The governing body oversees a vast global real estate portfolio held in regional headquarters and kingdom halls built by congregations around the world.
They're a big multi-billion dollar asset business.
As a religious charity, it receives significant tax exemptions.
A charity doesn't have to pay income tax on its earnings. It may also have deductible gift recipient status, which is where the donor gets the tax write-off. There may be other taxes, including state taxes, which are forgiven for charities.
I think it's really ironic that an organization that has predicted that the end of the world is imminent and predicted the end four times, the last time in 1975, would create a long-term investment portfolio with real estate that they carefully maintained and made a great deal of money on.
In a book titled The Vatican Billions, the late Avery Manhattan, when comparing the vast difference between the early apostolic church and the modern-day church, said that Christ was born, lived, and died in poverty. His church is a multi-billion concern. How come that although she claims to be preoccupied with the riches of heaven, she is in reality one of the most formidable accumulators of the riches of the earth. The true early church acted upon and indeed practiced the tenets of Jesus Christ, transporting the accumulation of the treasures of heaven before the accumulation of the earth. These are the words of a secular writer. A century before, the Russian novelist Leo Tolstoy documented that all of the churches are nothing more than a copy or a model of the papacy, just in different forms, and he rebuked them and he said that in one breath they teach children to love thy neighbor as thyself. Then in another breath, Western Christian nations slaughter each other in endless wars. In his book titled The Kingdom of God is Within You, banned in Russia but published in Germany in 1894, on his conversion to Christianity, a few excerpts of it read that the teaching of Christ guides men differently from the way in which the precepts found on the lower conception of life guide men. This primitive church was founded on equality, liberty and fraternity, gentleness, meekness, peacefulness and forgiveness of injuries. Not only have the churches never bound men together in unity, talking about the modern churches, they have always been one of the principal causes of division between men, of their hatred of one another, of wars, battles, inquisitions, massacres of Saint Bartholomew, and so on. What does he mean? In 1933, with the covert support of the international bankers in both Europe and the United States, Adolf Hitler became the Reichsfuhrer of Nazi Germany. With the odd opposition from a small minority of Christians led by Dietrich Bonhoeffer, all of the Protestants in Nazi Germany alongside the Catholic Church gave their absolute patriotic allegiance to Adolf Hitler, and the recent documents are slowly coming out confirming this. The late Irish-American Catholic Jesuit priest Friar Edmund Wells created the very first diplomatic school in the United States of America, the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown University in Washington, D.C. And the late Irish-American Cardinal Francis Joseph Spellman was the 6th Archbishop of New York and the military vicar of the United States Armed Forces who supported U.S. military actions overseas. One of the most horrific episodes of modern warfare was when the United States dropped an atomic weapon on Japan in Asia in World War II, whose devastation even shocked the pilots. The bomb was blessed by this man, who has been recently identified as a Roman Catholic priest. In the United States, the Christians have supported war since the Puritans first landed in the 17th century. Not much has changed since then. They still support the US military wars that kill so many innocent civilians around the world. And former President Donald Trump, who still has a strong cult-like evangelical support base, in one breath says he wants to save human life inside of a woman's womb by attending an anti-abortion political rally, but then kills a high number of people outside of the womb on death row in his own country. And outside of his country, he continued US foreign policy by destroying a high number of men, women, and children by dropping drones on innocent civilians in the continents of both Asia and Africa. There has never been that much of a major difference between the Catholics and all the other churches. They only differ in name. The Russian Orthodox Church blesses not only its soldiers in war, but also the Russian military's high-tech, sophisticated weaponry to maim and kill bodies in warfare. The number one argument the narrator has faced from the Gentile world from a child, beginning in primary school, up until he matured into an adult, is that they always complain that the churches either provoke, start, finance, get involved in, or support bloody wars. And when Christians endorse those global economic bloodbaths, it only makes the world hate God more and more. Tolstoy continues. Every church traces its creed through an uninterrupted transmission from Christ to the apostles. But that does not prove that it alone, of all that has transmitted, excluding all the rest, can be the sole truth, admitting of no doubt. The churches are everywhere the same. Is the religion of Catholicism any other than that of the Russian church? There is the same external ritual, the same relics, miracles and wonder-working images of Notre Dame, and the same processions. The same lofty, vague discussions of Christianity in books and sermons. And when it comes to practice, the same supporting of the same idolatry. And is not the same thing done in Anglicanism, Lutheranism, and every denomination of Protestantism which has been formed into a church? The Protestants of every kind, Lutherans, Reformed Church, Presbyterians, Swedenborgians, Mormons, assert that the Holy Ghost is only present in their communities. Nearly all the churches make this claim. If there is a Catholic Church now which asserts its own infallibility, that is only because there are churches which are Greco-Russian, Old Orthodox and Lutheran, each asserting its own infallibility and denying that of other churches. The Sermon on the Mount, which are the words of Jesus, or the Creed, thus saith my church. One cannot believe in both, and churchmen have chosen to follow their church instead of Jesus. True faith consists in believing the word of God. Though more and more evidence is coming out that the papacy is loaded with billions and has accumulated huge amounts of wealth for way over a millennium all over the world, according to Revelation chapters 17 and 18, the other churches are no different. They also have gazillions in real estate, stocks and property, and are decked with financial bling. And their tele-evangelist preachers are also reaping the benefits, and they are given even more billions by their church members. Very little or none of it is going to the poor in need in society with their huge portfolios of wealth. They are also tax exempt, as they are chartered as registered charities, and they also receive money from the state, which the narrator has also shown in a previous study. Everything the narrator is telling you is what the people in the secular world told him. So how do you plan to tell the world about eternity when your own church system and your individual lives are also not preparing for it themselves? They will think that you are a complete fraud. That is why there will be two distinct types of Christians at the very end. There will be the majority lukewarm Laodiceans who will hide their talent in the earth and will do nothing for the Lord. These keyboard terrorists will only look to criticize people in their quiet digital space and will do nothing for the kingdom of God. But you will have a serious set of people who will be a very small minority known as the 11th hour workers. They will be faithful to the word of God only and will not conform to any man-made quasi-religious groupthink dogmas. They will have the daily struggles, for fully surrendering to God by faith is no joke. You will not see them gossiping as talebearers, for it is gossip that brought down one third of the angels from heaven. Gossip is a destructive satanic custom. You will never see them humiliating their own people in the public, for how you treat your own people affects how people perceive God. You will never see them getting involved in either online or public debates, for the life that they live will be an open debate. They will never rejoice when they see someone fall, whether they be godly or ungodly, because they know that it will upset the Lord. For true Christians restore broken people back to spiritual health in the spirit of meekness. Jesus, laying the example, said that he did not come to destroy men's lives, but he came to save them. When people praise them, they will never take any credit at all, but give all the glory to God. For when you're doing true mission work, You're not looking for any glory from man or seeking any self-praise, for that is falling into the subtle trap of Luciferianism. Self, worship, all glory goes to Yahweh, the Most High. When people threaten them, they will pray for their enemies and when all of their friends and family and all the church brethren, including their leaders, turn on them and hand them over to the state to be persecuted as conspiracy theorists. They will not be like the weak Christians of today who suffer with a daily victimhood of a persecution complex. They will boldly tell them, "We would rather obey God than man," because they cannot put anyone on this earth before their God. For if they deny God, Jesus makes it very clear, he also will deny them. For those who are on the spiritual battlefield do not love their lives unto the death. For he that hateth his life for the kingdom's sake shall indeed save it. They will not have a critical spirit and a judgmental nature. For they will look upon individuals and realize that they were also once in bondage to sin. And they will have compassion on individuals, not caring about their outward appearance. And they will win souls to Christ outside of the pomp and ceremony of social media and the video camera. But they will also realize that they have a very heavy task ahead of them if they really want to reach the 7 to 8 billion people on this earth. They will have to learn a number of different strategies to reach the people in this digital age, and they will have to learn how to reach people of different cultures and ethnicities, for the indwelling power of the Holy Spirit will help them to break down racial and cultural barriers. They will have to learn how to be creative. Stop distributing outdated literature. You have to adapt to the modern age. You don't change your message, but you change your method. There are a lot of very, very lonely, hurt and broken people out there suffering from neglect of society, rejection from both family and friends, and who are suffering from anxiety, depression and all different forms of psychological deficiencies. And it is the church's responsibility to reach out and love them before you judge them. For the vast majority of Jesus' ministry was outreach. That is why he was so effective. The church should be offering free counsel to people in society with no charge and consoling those who are deeply broken and feel like outcasts. You see, the narrator's church once offered free blood pressure to the community. And when people can see that you have their sincere interest at heart without an agenda or an ulterior motive, they will open up to you. The narrator's church also once offered free massages to the public. You see, billion-dollar institutions should not be charging people for a service. The church should also offer free aerobics classes for both young and elderly to keep them healthy, and train people how to cook for free with the multitudes of talent they have inside of the church. For if these principles are adopted, people will respect you a lot more when they see you have their interest. That is why people listen to anything Jesus had to say, because he dealt with their needs first before even telling them about the end times. Invite the young also, who will also help them to respect adults and to also break down the deep-rooted racial barriers. Jesus fed the poor for free, and when you feed them with proper fresh food, no outdated foolishness, they may also listen to anything you have to say. For a while, the narrator did prison ministry. It was a blessing and a joy. The inmates will really challenge you and test your faith with very difficult questions. But they will respect you when you don't get defensive and when they realize that you know your stuff. And if any church wants to really be truly effective in this modern climate to prepare people for the end times, you need to step out of your comfort zone by faith as the 11th hour workers, and do not worry about opposition, for you are going to get it. There are many at this time who are in the valley of decision. They are disillusioned with their churches and they are wrestling with the desire to be faithful to Jesus Christ and his word, or conforming to this world. It will be a very, very intense battle. But if you remain faithful without the fear of being labeled as a conspiracy theorist, God will see you through to the end.
I receive feedback every now and then from a couple of my friends, and it's an age. We try to sit down and talk with people about current affairs or about Bible prophecy, and they're just not interested. We share your videos and they just shut off. And I always respond with, listen, if you have no interest in God, if you have no interest in current affairs, why are you going to sit down for 2 hours looking at what's taking place in the world? It's not going to interest them. So always tell them, listen, just plant the seed and leave them alone. Don't argue, don't debate, don't get angry. Just share and you've done your part. So the next video will be titled, How to Study History. You see, there have been a couple of people who've asked me how to research, where do I get my cameras from, how to deal with criticism. And it's going to be kind of like a journey, showing you how I started, even at the doors, the struggles that I faced, how I confront criticism, etc. So as I encourage at all times, and I repeat again, please research everything you see, not just in this video, but in all the videos from Even at the Doors.